It is our Pentecost Sunday. It's a very important Sunday in a born-again Christian's life. And today we're going to talk about Pentecost. And I want us to watch a short, not a short clip, it's going to be a 5 to 8 minute clip that's going to talk a little bit about Pentecost, and then we're going to go into the Word. So if you are ready, media, let's have that clip.
Pentecost, a word steeped in the annals of history, resonating with layers of tradition and significance. Yet, on a pivotal day in the heart of Jerusalem, its essence transcended mere ritual and tradition celebrating the past. Pentecost, as depicted in the New Testament scripture, is when the Holy Spirit descended upon the apostles and other believers in the form of tongues of fire, symbolizing divine presence and empowerment. These flames rested upon each of them, signifying the impartation of spiritual gifts and the beginning of their mission to spread the gospel to all nations. On this particular Pentecost, the world witnessed the fulfillment of ancient prophecies and the birth of a new era, becoming a beacon of divine intervention and transformation.
I remember it vividly. Though I wasn't there with the disciples in the upper room, I remember standing in that crowd, shoulder to shoulder with strangers, yet bound by a common curiosity. There were Jews from all nations gathered in Jerusalem for the feast, and the air in the city crackled with anticipation, as if the very heavens leaned in to listen.
I recall the murmurs of expectancy rippling through the crowds. People talked about the followers of Jesus that were filled with the Holy Spirit. They spoke about tongues of fire dancing above their heads. They spoke in different languages.
We may not have been among the 12, but little did we know. We stood witness to the birth pangs of a movement that would shake the foundations of the world.
Later that day, Peter, one of Jesus' disciples, addressed the crowd. His words thundered like a revelation, piercing through hearts of men, igniting a fire that no earthly force could quench.
Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out.
Peter's sermon, it was like he was speaking right to my soul. He spoke in boldness about Jesus, about how we crucified and killed the Son of God. But he also spoke about how Jesus had been crucified and raised from the dead, about forgiveness, about the Holy Spirit, about how to be right with God. It was like a revelation unfolding before our very eyes.
I felt it in my bones. The weight of his words, the urgency in his voice. It was as if he spoke directly to me, unraveling the doubts and fears that had entangled me for so long. Just a few weeks ago, I was crying, "Crucify him." And yet, now I stood here, captivated, yearning to be set free from the guilt of taking part in murdering the Savior. I felt convicted, convicted of a lifetime of sins.
I remember the day of his crucifixion. I'm ashamed to say that I was one of the women standing next to the road, mocking the tortured and tired Jesus as he dragged his cross along the road to the hill. And a few days later, I scoffed. I heard one of the women who followed him say, she saw a resurrected Jesus. I laughed in her face. How can a man be resurrected from the dead? I was ignorant. I didn't believe.
I was convicted of my sin.
Of my need for a savior.
And when Peter said,
repent and be baptized, every one of you,
in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sin,
and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit,
I knew I had to respond.
As Peter's sermon reached this crescendo, the Spirit moved mightily among the people. Hearts were convicted, and souls surrendered to the call of repentance.
As I was compelled to respond, by the conviction to ask for forgiveness and accept Christ's redemption, I witnessed men and women, young and old, coming forward with tears streaming down their faces, their hearts laid bare before God. That day, 3,000 souls were added to the kingdom of God, a testament to the power of the gospel.
And as they were baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, a tangible sense of joy and freedom permeated the atmosphere. I myself made the decision to go through the water. I felt at peace. I felt compelled to tell others about the risen Christ. It was a moment of a divine encounter, a foretaste of the kingdom of heaven breaking through on earth.
Pentecost was not merely a historical event, but a divine mandate. It was the inauguration of a movement that was spread across the globe, transcending barriers of language, culture, and creed. The true purpose of Pentecost was not just the manifestation of signs and wonders, but the building of the church and the commission to make disciples of all nations. And for the individual, Pentecost represents the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, bringing about personal transformation, empowering a person to become a believer, to live a holy and righteous life through the redemptive power of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Pentecost, the coming down of God's Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, verse 1 to 13, we read the following. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like a roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other tongues, as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. At that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. How can this be? They exclaimed, these people are all from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages. Here we are, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judah, all the big names from all the province of Asia. Amen. Help me out here. Visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. And we all hear these people speaking in our own languages about the wonderful things God has done. They stood there amazed and perplexed. What can this mean? They ask each other. But others in the crowd ridiculed them, saying, they just drunk, that is all. Friends, in the Old Testament, Pentecost was the feast which occurred 50 days after Passover. As the Passover feast celebrate the exodus of the Israelites from slavery in Egypt, so Pentecost celebrates God's gift of the Ten Commandments given to Moses on Mount Sinai. In the New Testament, the Passover event takes on its new meaning as the celebration of Christ's death and resurrection, the exodus of man from a sinful world into the kingdom of God. So we have three main feasts in Judaism: Passover, Pentecost, and, come on, anybody? Anybody? Passover? Say again? Yeah, but what's the English word for it? There's three main feasts. Passover is the beginning. Passover is where the Israelites moved from out of Egypt, under Pharaoh, under slavery, into the wilderness, about to the promised land. Then we've got Pentecost. Pentecost, the first picture of Pentecost, was when God came down and gave the Ten Commandments to Moses on Mount Sinai. We are talking about Pentecost today because Pentecost is the coming down of God's Spirit. Pentecost happened 50 days after Passover. Today we celebrate Pentecost as the day where God gave us not His law to guide us or to protect us, but gave His Spirit to dwell in us and empower us. So the first picture of Pentecost was Moses going up in the mountain, the Lord coming down to meet Moses, then gave him the Ten Commandments as a guide and a protection of the people. Are you guys with me? And then we fast forward into the New Testament where we find Pentecost 50 days after Passover, when Jesus went up into heaven, the Spirit of God came down upon God's people to dwell in us and to empower us for purpose. Pentecost was a Jewish holiday held 50 days after Passover. It was one of the three major feasts during the Jewish year. It celebrates thanksgiving of the harvest crops. So if you go back into the Old Testament, it was a celebration of the harvest crops. The harvest crops was the picture of the coming church of Jesus Christ on planet Earth. The first picture of Pentecost occurred in the Old Testament in the book of Exodus 12. It forms part of the deliverance process of the people of God out of Egypt. So even though it's three distinctive feasts, it is all part of the deliverance process, bringing God's people out of slavery into the promised land. Passover can be recognized by the blood of the lambs being put on the doorposts in Egypt. So I want to explain to you, because Pentecost is just not an event. It is part of the deliverance process of God, bringing God's people out of Egypt into the promised land. Every one of these feasts in the Old Testament had great significance and is very important for us to understand our deliverance process from a sinful world into the kingdom of God. So, when we look at Passover, you will find that when the Israelites was in Egypt, the Lord said to Moses, "This is what I want you to do. I want you to take the lamb, slaughter the lamb, and put the blood on the doorposts of every house." That is a symbol of the cross in every house. So no one in that house that had the blood will die. The second thing that happened was that the Holy Spirit and Moses led the people from out of Egypt through the Red Sea, through the sea, into the wilderness. So what do we recognize as well? We recognize them going through the water. You will find that when they left Egypt after Pharaoh said, "Let them go now, you know, my firstborn is dead, I don't want you here anymore," the Holy Spirit, by a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day, led the people with the help of Moses into the wilderness. And the second big thing that they went through is the water. Stay with me, it's going to make sense a bit later. Then we find, after they get through the water, the pillar was not in front of them anymore by night, and the cloud was not in front of them anymore by day, as they came through the water, the pillar came upon them. And the cloud came upon them. Okay, so the three main elements you're seeing here is what? The blood, the water, and the spirit. The fire, the pillar by fire, and the cloud is the is this element or a focus point of the Holy Spirit. So when you look at that journey of the disciples, not the disciples, of the people of Israel coming out of Egypt, you can see the deliverance process of the church as well. How God will take us from a world of sin, under slavery of sin, Pharaoh as Satan, and how God will deliver us and bring us into the promised land. So, the first descent of God's Spirit was over the whole nation of Israel. So, you get there, the picture, the cloud is not leading them anymore, the cloud came upon them. And that is a picture of God's Spirit that is now upon them. And then we also find a picture where God came upon His nation as He brought the Ten Commandments, as He come over the mountain. Now we read in Exodus chapter 19, it says, exactly 2 months after the Israelites left Egypt, they arrived in the wilderness of Sinai. After breaking camp at Rephidim, they came to the wilderness of Sinai and set up camp there at the base of Mount Sinai. Then Moses climbed the mountain to appear before God. Now, Moses climbed the mountain to appear before God. Then Moses climbed the mountain to appear before God. The Lord called him from the mountain and said, give these instructions to the family of Jacob. Announce it to the descendants of Israel. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians. You know how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you will obey me and keep my covenant, you will be my own special treasure from among all the peoples on the earth, for all the earth belongs to me. And you will be my kingdom of priests, my holy nation. This is the message you must give to the people of Israel. So Moses returned from the mountain and called together the elders of the people and told them everything the Lord had commanded him. And all the people responded together, we will do everything the Lord has commanded. So Moses brought the people's answer back to the Lord up the mountain again. Then the Lord said to Moses, I will come to you in a thick cloud, Moses, so the people themselves can hear me when I speak with them. They will always trust you. Moses told the Lord what the people had said. Then the Lord told Moses, go down and prepare the people for my arrival. Consecrate them today and tomorrow and have them wash their clothing. Be sure they are ready on the third day. For on that day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai as all the people watch. Mark off a boundary all around the mountain. Warn the people, be careful. Do not go up on the mountain or even touch the boundaries. Anyone who touches the mountain will certainly be put to death. No hand may touch the person or animal that crosses the boundary. Instead, stone them or shoot them with arrows. They must be put to death. However, when the ram's horn sounds a long blast, then the people may go up on the mountain. So Moses went down to the people, down again. He consecrated them for worship, and they washed their clothes. And he told them, get ready for the third day, and until then, abstain from having sexual intercourse. On the morning of the third day, thunder roar and lightning flashed, and a dense cloud came down on the mountain. There was a long, loud blast from a ram's horn, and all the people trembled. Moses led them out from the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. All of Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord had descended on it in the form of fire. The smoke billowed into the sky like smoke from a brick kiln, and the whole mountain shook violently. As the blast of the ram's horn grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God thundered his reply. The Lord came down on the top of Mount Sinai and called Moses to the top of the mountain. up go Moses again. Just remember, Moses is 80 years here. I mean, some of you are struggling with the stairs or come to church every Sunday. Yeah, Moses, go up that mountain, down that mountain, up that mountain, down that mountain. So Moses climbed the mountain. Then the Lord told Moses, go back down and warn the people not to break through the boundaries to see the Lord, or they will die. Even the priests who regularly come near the Lord must purify themselves so that the Lord does not break out and destroy them. But Lord, Moses protested, the people cannot come up to Mount Sinai. You already warned us. You told me, mark off a boundary all around the mountain to set it apart as holy. But the Lord said, go down and bring Aaron back with you. In the meantime, do not let the priest or the people break through to approach the Lord, or he will break out and destroy them. So Moses went down to the people and told them what the Lord had said. Why is this piece of scripture so important? It explains to us the heart of God. God always wanted his presence, his spirit, to be upon his people. As a born-again Christian, you are the final picture of what God wants for humanity. Here we find, through the feasts, a celebration of God's deliverance of his people from Egypt into the promised land. Every feast is important. Passover speaks about the blood of the lamb and the crossing of the sea. Then we find Pentecost as a symbol, as a sign of how God came down upon the people. He wanted his spirit to be among his people, to be upon his people. But ultimately, the purpose of Pentecost is for the spirit of God to be upon the individual and to stay in and upon the individual. And that makes the Church of Jesus Christ, the Spirit-filled, born-again Church of Jesus Christ, unique. That makes us special. That makes us the royal priests. As he said, yeah, you will be a royal priesthood to myself. You are my special treasure. The second descent of God's Spirit was to be upon the individual. Even though God came down upon the nation, the born-again church, Jesus will come down through the Holy Spirit upon the individual. It is always for God about the individual. The people in the old covenant were not ready to receive the Spirit. That's why God says, do not come closer. I want to be among you. I want to be upon you. I ultimately want to be in you. But there is something keeping me from doing that. And if you are going to approach me not being ready, that's not going to be good for you. So clearly we find through this that the people were not ready to receive the Spirit yet. Even though they were purified and consecrated on the outside, they were inwardly immoral and not on God's standard. That's what sin did with Adam and Eve. It caused us to lose the Spirit and become immoral on the inside. So God, through the journey of the Old Testament, through giving us the law, through showing us all this, giving us all the feasts, showing us the picture of what he would do in the future with the church, showing how he would deliver us, how he will sanctify and separate us, and how he will ultimately, through the experience of Pentecost, come to empower the individual believer for purpose. We find in the very next chapter of the Word of God, God gives his people the Ten Commandments, the law. The Ten Commandments, which we know today, was given to expose the inner sin, or sin on the inside, of people. The Ten Commandments was not given to condemn us. The Ten Commandments was given to us to protect and guide us and lead us to a place where we would ultimately see Jesus and accept him. So when you read the Ten Commandments, the Ten Commandments was to expose the immoral state, the sinful state in us. So when you look at that, you see, but hey, I cannot measure up to the standard that God requires. And no matter how much I try to fulfill all these commandments, I can never achieve that. So the Bible says that the Lord puts us in protective custody by giving us the law. You see the heart of God over here. He says to Moses, tell the people, do not cross. Do not come up. Do not come close to me because they will be destroyed. So God is never out to destroy his people. God's always out to protect his people. But God has a standard for us to approach him. God has a way for us to approach him. We cannot just come in an immoral state and get into the presence of God and think everything is going to be okay. No, God wants to make us new. God wants us to come on his terms. And God wants the church to be empowered by his Spirit. The third covering of the Spirit is clearly seen in the life of Jesus. The third picture in the Bible of the descending of the Spirit of God is in the picture of Jesus. This shows us that God's ultimate plan was not just to come upon his people, but ultimately to come upon his people and stay. And you will find when you look at Jesus that he was the first man that the Spirit descended upon and remained upon. In John 1 verse 33, it says, I did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptized with the Holy Spirit. So John the Baptist said, listen, I have come to baptize you with water. But after me comes one that will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So Jesus was the first man that received the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit stayed upon him. Why did it work for Jesus? Because Jesus was morally right with God. Jesus was not born as a sinner into this world, but as an incorruptible vessel, the Son of God. Not just was he born an incorruptible vessel, he was also obedient to the covenant requirements of God. Ever wondered why Jesus got baptized? Remember, God showed us Passover. God showed us Pentecost. God showed us the fulfillment of the whole process of deliverance through the three feasts. Then God showed us how he commanded Moses to put the lamb's blood on the doorposts and nobody in the house died. Are you guys with me? Then God took the Israelites through the Red Sea. We see the water. Then we see God coming upon his people in the Old Testament. We find the Spirit of God come upon Saul, come upon David, come upon the prophets. But the Spirit of God never indwelled God's people. Are you guys with me? Now we find Jesus coming, born without sin, in the standard that God requires. So Jesus was incorruptible, was not born a sinner. Yet Jesus had to obey the covenant requirements. That's why when he went to get himself baptized by John the Baptist, you find in Matthew chapter 3, I think he said, but I cannot baptize you. You have to baptize me. So John the Baptist looked at Jesus and said, you know, I'm under you, actually. I know who you are. So you come to me to baptize you. I actually should be baptized by you. But Jesus said to him, permit it to be so now, for this is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. So that Jesus is actually saying to him, listen, you are the appointed authority of God. I'm not yet that. So I am submitting to my Father's will because I'm not a sinner, but yet my Father requires in this covenant for me to go through the water, because that shows people the deliverance process. That's why Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and the only way to the Father. So as God showed us, taking the disciples out of Egypt, then through the Red Sea, and then on the other side, he came upon them. He showed us with the life of Jesus, the ultimate picture. Jesus, incorruptible, yet still going through the water, then coming out on the other side, the Spirit didn't just come upon him, but stayed on him or in him. The Spirit started to dwell in humanity again. What can we see through this process? Blood, water, Holy Spirit. What did we see with Jesus? Jesus didn't need blood. He wasn't a sinner. He was incorruptible. Yet he needed to go through the water, and the Holy Spirit filled him and stayed upon him. And the same experience is what God wants for human beings today. Because the promise of God is not just the forgiveness of sins or the sanctification unto him, but the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. God's ultimate promise is for his Spirit to be in and among his people. And that's why Pentecost is so important to us, because that day, the Spirit of God, can you remember when Jesus died, that the veil in the temple torn into pieces? That was a sign that the Holy Spirit can now come upon, can be among all who believe. And God was looking for people to get born again. God was looking for moral vessels, incorrupt vessels, coming through the water so that he can come upon them and stayed in them. In John 14, verse 15, it says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray to the Father, and he will give you another helper. I'm your first helper, but I will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. It will not leave you. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you a little while longer, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me, because I live and you will live also. At that day, you will know that I am in my Father and you are in me and I in you. So who's the people that can receive the promise of the Spirit? Those who love God and keep his commandments. Those who received a new spirit from God. Those who became incorruptible vessels. Friends, the Holy Spirit does not dwell in corruptible vessels. In the Old Testament, you can clearly see that the people couldn't even get into his presence because they were corruptible. They were not ready. So we need to understand this as the born-again church today. Not everybody that shouts Jesus has the Holy Spirit. The world cannot receive, unborn again person cannot receive the Spirit of God. Because they do not see him, nor knows him. Can you remember when Nicodemus came to Jesus and says, we know that you're a prophet that come, or a teacher comes from God, because no one can do the things that you are doing except you are from God. Come on, talk to me. He actually said to him, we serve God but you demonstrate to us that God is with you. So there's something different between you and what is that? That Jesus said, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom. What is Jesus saying over here? Who can receive the Spirit? Those who can see the kingdom. And you can only see the kingdom of God when you get born again. Those who do not see cannot receive the Holy Spirit. You can cry as much as you want. You can argue as much as you want. But the Spirit of God does not come down upon and stay in vessels that's corruptible. He needs an incorruptible vessel. And he needs a born-again spirit that is incorruptible for the Holy Spirit to take home there. So how can a person see Jesus? Jesus answered and said to Nicodemus, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You must have a born again experience to have a Pentecost experience. You cannot have a Pentecost experience without first having a born again experience. Nicodemus said to Jesus, how can a man be born when he's old? How can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. A lot of religious people argue that he's talking here of water when people are born. It's not, it isn't. The Greek word there is water of the deluge. It is waters of rivers, water of ponds, and waters of the sea. So where do you baptize people? Rivers, ponds, seas, and in our case, baths. Amen. Have you been baptized in a bath? Well, somebody said to me, yeah, but it must be running water. I say, open the tap, pull out the plug, you've got running water. But what is the bottom line over here? When God delivered Israel, he gave us three main feasts, all as a picture of his people's deliverance from slavery. We find blood in Egypt, making sure that the firstborn does not die, but live. Then take the whole nation through the sea. Then at the other side, covers the whole nation with his Spirit. Then he starts to teach his people as a man goes up the mountain to meet with God, God's Spirit comes down to meet with him. And God started to train his people that it's not his heart to destroy them. His heart is to protect them, but he cannot meet with them because they are not corrupt. They are incorruptible vessels. So what does God do? He says, listen, I'm going to give you my law because my law is going to protect you. My law is going to teach you how to approach me in this season before Jesus comes. And my law is not just going to protect you. My law is going to guide you. And my law is ultimately going to show you that I am not out to destroy you, but there's something on the inside that's already killing you and keeping you from a relationship with me. How gracious is God? And through the whole Testament, the people are having the three feasts. God is showing the blood, the water, and the Spirit. Then Jesus came. And what did Jesus do? Jesus knew he was without sin. He didn't need the blood. Hello. But he still had to fulfill and be obedient to the requirements of the covenant that others will follow behind him. He submitted, got baptized, not sprinkled, not as a baby. He submitted under the leadership of God on planet Earth, the legitimate leadership, not man's leadership, not the Pharisees, the Sadducees, but the appointed person, John the Baptist, gone through the water. As he gone through the water, the Spirit of God came upon him and stayed upon him. And for a human being after Jesus to go through the same deliverance process, the first step must be for God to give you a new spirit. You must be born again. When you get born again, you see the kingdom of God. You see Jesus for who he is. Then you still need to take that new spirit, hello, through the water, so that the Holy Spirit can come upon you and dwell in its fullness in you. And when the Holy Spirit comes upon you and fills you, you experience Pentecost. So every human being that goes up to God, any human being that reaches up to God needs to know that God will come down and meet with him. When you go up into God, his Spirit comes down upon you and remains in you. That's why God says that whoever believes shall be saved. He makes that promise that if you go up into me, if you seek me, you will find me. If you go up, I will come down and make my home with you. Jesus promises it to his disciples and to all those who follow him, that he will not leave us orphans, as orphans. He will come to make his home with us. He will go up to the Father in heaven. That's what he did. The Holy Spirit will come down from the Father as our helper to be just like Jesus, to be with us 24/7, 365 for eternity. How does a man get born again, you might ask? Acts chapter 2, verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Here Peter preached the first sermon of the New Testament. What is the result of the proper preaching of the gospel? People's hearts get cut. The first sermon was not about faith. The first sermon was not about Jesus loves you. The first sermon was to explain to humanity how to leave Egypt and get into the promised land with God. So here Peter stood up and he preached mostly to believers, Jewish people believing in God. They were self-righteous. They thought they were the people of God. They thought they were right with God. And Peter said to them, even though you think you're right with God, what you actually did is you killed God's son. That is a big no-no. You cannot be right with God if you just killed his son. And the evidence of his son being killed and are now resurrected and alive is his Spirit speaking through his believers. And when they heard that, the Bible says they were cut to the heart and they said to Peter and the apostles, what must we do? Now look what Peter said to them. Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, that you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are 2,024 years later, afar off, as many as the Lord will call. Family, the process of delivering God's people out of Egypt and bring them into the promised land, it was a simple process. The blood in Egypt, the water, and God's rest staying upon them. Man made it difficult. Man confused it. The Pharisees and the Sadducees confused it in such a way that it made it so difficult for people to find God. Then Jesus came and he said, I'm going to show you, look at my life. I'm going to show you how easy it is. I'm born without sin, so you have to be reborn and not be a sinner. I'm not a sinner. I'm born into this world, but I'm not a sinner. I obey God's instructions. I go through the water. I submit to God's directions. And I come out on the other side. The Holy Spirit comes and lives in me forever. How simple is that? And then when Jesus left, what did the disciples do? They started to preach the same journey. When people ask, what must we do to be right? He says, repent of your sins. The moment you stand before God and you say, God, forgive me of all my sin, what happens? The Bible says the blood of Jesus covers you. When the blood of Jesus covers you, he recreates you. The moment the blood comes over you, it consumes the sinner and it resurrects the righteous. In that moment, the moment that you truly repent and believe in Jesus is the moment the blood covers you. You are in the house with the doorpost and you will not die. You are alive. You become the firstborn of God. So every time somebody pray the repentance prayer and put their faith and hope in Jesus, that moment the blood of Christ covers that sinner, consumes that sinner's sin, and resurrects a new spirit in that being. That spirit is now incorruptible and righteous. So what must that incorruptible and righteous spirit do? Jesus said, obey my commandments. Amen. That's why I ask people that's not baptized, if you are truly born again from the same spirit that I got born again from, why is your born again spirit not telling you to go through the water? Why are you arguing to get baptized if you are truly born again? Because the new spirit follows the word of God. And it's only man that came in to confuse you, to tell you you were baptized as a baby. There's no such thing. No baby can repent. Every baby born onto this planet is born a sinner. So no baby can apply the blood for themselves. So a baby must come to a point where they realize they were a sinner, ask God to forgive them, get born again, then obey. As Jesus obeyed, as the apostles obeyed, come through the water so that they could be filled with the Holy Spirit. So what do we need? A heart that is cut, a heart that is changed by God. Didn't Jesus promise that I will take out that heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh? I will come and change your heart. So any person that wants to live in the power and the fullness of God must have the blood applied to their lives, must have the water where they go through, and must be filled with the Holy Spirit for eternity. Do your life have the three elements? 1 Peter 5, it says there are three witnesses in heaven speaking about you and I. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and they are one. It says, and there's three witnesses on earth that witnesses about you. The blood, the water, and the Spirit. And they agree as one. In Acts chapter 1, verse 4 and 8, it says, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father. This gets me excited. The promise was not only for you to get saved. Jesus said, I've got a baptism that I want to baptize you with, and I cannot wait to baptize you with that. The goal is not for you just to be recreated. The goal is for God's Spirit to empower you to live in and among you forever and ever. The promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it's not for you to know times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power. It's not about to know when Jesus comes back, when he's going to come. Is he going to come? Is it the end of days? The purpose of the Holy Spirit was not for you to find out that information. The purpose of the Holy Spirit is for you to receive power. And for you to receive power to be a witness to the nations. Your Pentecost experience is not for you. It's not for you to have a goosebump. It's not for you to speak in another language. The purpose of the Holy Spirit was to empower you to be a vessel that God needs to bring the gospel to the nations. Pentecost is the ascension of a man into heaven and the descension of the Spirit of God onto the earth. Because Jesus went up, the Holy Spirit came down to live and remain in our lives. Pentecost is the promise of God being fulfilled. Pentecost happened for restoration and empowerment. Pentecost is the release of God's power into the individual. Pentecost is making the individual believer a witness to nations. The Holy Spirit was and is the promise to all believers. God wants you, believer, to have your own Pentecost experience. You must have the tongue of fire upon you. And when the tongue of fire rests upon you, you will turn into a different being. Your utterance will change. Your speech will change. Your life will change. Pentecost in a believer's life is for purpose. It's for the power to be a witness and to speak God's truth to a dying world. A sure sign of a person being filled with the Holy Spirit, you can put the scripture up there, I'm not going to read it, is through a person's utterance that changes. When you are filled with the Holy Spirit and fire, your utterance change, not just your prayer language. When you are filled with the Spirit of God, you will speak like the Spirit of God. When you are not filled by the Spirit of God, you cannot speak like God. But you will speak like man, or you will speak like the Spirit that you are filled with. You see, that's why Satan does not want born-again believers to go through the water or to be filled with the Spirit of God. Because if you are not filled with the Spirit of God, you are not His. You need to understand that God has to seal you. He has to seal the deal. He has not taken you through this without sealing the deal. Stay with me. Because you can be born again and be filled in your soul dimension with a worldly spirit, a demonic spirit, a lying spirit. That's why He wants to prevent you from being baptized. He wants to prevent you from being from having a Pentecost experience. Tells you all kinds of nonsense that you should, not every believer prays in tongues. Well, every one of them, it's a lie from the pit of hell. Is it possible for professing Christians not to experience Pentecost in their own lives and not to be filled with God's Spirit? Is it possible that you can be born again and not experience Pentecost? Yes, it is possible. It's possible to be born again and not be filled with the Spirit of God. In Acts chapter 19, verse 1 and 7, it says, "It happened when Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus and find some disciples." He said, finding some disciples, he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" So they said to him, "We have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said to them, "Into what were you baptized?" They said, "Into the baptism of John, into water." Then Paul said, "John indeed baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them. And they spoke with tongues and prophesied." It is sad to say today that many born-again believers live their lives not being filled by the Holy Spirit. Many millions never had a Pentecost experience. In Acts chapter 2, 38, 39, it says, Peter replied, each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peter said that this is God's plan for a human being and His purpose and His will for you to receive His Spirit into your life. Why is it so important to be filled with the Holy Spirit? Jesus needs to baptize every believer with the Holy Spirit to seal them for the day of redemption. He needs to seal the deal for the day of redemption. What does that mean? On the day of redemption, those who are sealed will be redeemed. It's like cover charge. In your old days, you want to go into the club? And they said, "Have you paid? Do you have the thing around your wristband? Do you have the seal to go in?" "No, but I know the owner. I know the owner's son. Hey, I went to the owner's house." What does that bouncer say? No seal, no deal. No seal, no deal. You know, the devil knows that. If God said, this is the seal, I need to seal you for the day of redemption. Satan knows that God ain't going to change his word for you. He didn't even change his word or his will for his son when his son was crying, praying tears of blood. He said it and it settled it. That's why when John said to Jesus, no, I need to be baptized by you. Jesus said to him, John, I know what you mean. But I'm here to do the will of my Father. I'm here to do what he told me to do, because I'm the picture of getting people out of sin and into the kingdom. That's why he said, permit it to be so now. Because after that, John went to prison and they chopped his head off. Why his head? As a sign that the legitimate authority of God on planet Earth is removed. That's why you chop the head. But when Satan chopped the head of John, because Jesus submitted to the leadership, to the way, Jesus became the legitimate authority. Ephesians 4:30 says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. And when you give yourself to Jesus, he gives himself to you. When you give yourself to God, God gives himself to you. Then today God wants to bring the Pentecost experience to individuals under my voice. The Holy Spirit is the power that brings back eternal life, the presence of God, forever into your being. The meaning of Pentecost was not to encourage believers to have an aesthetic experience for their own edification. The meaning of Pentecost is to bring the dead things to life, to bring the spirit of eternal life and the eternal God back into the lives of God's people. The meaning of Pentecost was that God gave the Holy Spirit to us, his church, so that we would bear witness to the nations for his glory and their salvation. It's not to get you out of poverty. It's not to get you a better house. It's not to get you a better life. If you have all of that and you do not have a change of utterance, speaking like God, speaking what God speaks, you have religion. You have the manifestation of the benefits, but something is missing. So, born again child of God, why are you not speaking what the word speaks? Why are you not speaking what the Spirit speaks? I'm not angry here this morning. I've got a righteous anger over me. Because some of you, shabba, 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 and your world is going to hell. Some of you are coming to church Sunday after Sunday, go to home cell week in, week out. No one gets saved through your life. The sad thing is, so many of you are in church today. I would say half of the people in this church has not even baptized one person in their life. But I need to accept that.
So you get them born again, but you don't seal them. Yeah. Do you know how wicked we are? Yeah. Wicked and lazy servants. Paul went to all the regions. He says, listen, guys, I know that you believed in Jesus, but hey, he realized, he discerned these people were following Jesus clueless. They did not have the guide, the helper with them. They do not have the light. He said to them, what were you baptized? He said, we were baptized in John's baptism in water. He says, no, brothers and sisters, you need to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. I need to seal you. That's what Pentecost is. When you have a Pentecost experience as a child of God, you know the importance of sealing the new believers. Amen. Laying on of hands. It says when Paul laid hands upon them, they were all filled and they start to speak in tongues. Are you leading them through the fullness of the deliverance process, or are you leaving them at the door? Come on, born again Christian. When last did you lead somebody through the sinner's prayer? When last did you baptize somebody? When last did you lay hands upon them to receive the Holy Spirit? To be sealed for the day of redemption. Just imagine, there's about 1,500 people today that will listen to this message. Just imagine if all of us make up our minds that this week, we will each find somebody, lead them to Jesus, get them through the water, and seal them with the Holy Spirit. Just imagine. The amazing thing about Jesus was that he said he's got one thing that he cannot wait to do. He never said, I've got one thing that I cannot wait to do, that's to forgive you of sins. You can't find that. But he said, I've got one thing and I can't wait to do it. And as we speak about Pentecost today, you need to know that one thing that Jesus is most exciting about is for a sinner to become a son and for the Spirit of God to take abode in that son or in that daughter. He gets excited when people get filled with the Holy Spirit. He gets excited when you lay hands upon them and they get filled with the Holy Spirit and they speak in other tongues. He gets excited when your language change, when you do not speak like your culture anymore. You don't speak like your family anymore. You speak like your spirit, like the Spirit of God. You utter the things of God. When God says this is sin, then you say that is sin. When God says this is good, then you say that is good. When God says this is wrong, then you say that is wrong. That was a lousy clap. I want to leave you with this, that God is most excited today when people experience Pentecost for themselves. And I want to encourage you, CRC, born-again believer, that you should also be excited for people to experience Pentecost for themselves. So we've got a job to do. We are not in heaven, but we are from heaven. We have a purpose. Our purpose is to win souls, to make disciples, to preach the gospel. And if you can't go to the end of the world, then start with your family and your friends. And I promise you, if you are faithful with your family and your friends, which is sometimes the most difficult, in it, come on. And you cut your teeth with them, God's going to send you to Judea, and then to Samaria, and then to the ends of the earth. You cannot have the Holy Spirit and make it about you. The Bible says the Spirit of God is like a rushing wind, like a rushing river. Have you seen a rushing river? You can't stop a rushing river. When you get in it, it just takes you. Is the Spirit of God rushing in you? Because it's, if it's rushing in you, you can't stay quiet. You just want to share it and give it to as many people you can. It's sad in the New Testament that Paul had to write to Timothy, and he says, Timothy, flame the fan the flame. This morning, I've seen the angels. Because some of you, there's not a flame anymore. They're trying to get the flame back. It shouldn't be. Child of God, it shouldn't be. No one should come and fan your flame. You should burst forth. Many times when we minister to people and when the Holy Spirit moves, on Friday night was a good example. Even now, speaking about it, there will be people in Seven Oaks and other campuses that get touched by the Spirit of God right now, because I can feel the rushing of the anointing flow, and it's flowing. Like Friday night, some people will stand across the room, 50 meters from myself as I minister, and the rushing of the Spirit will flow over them and knock them down. Some of you wonder, why are people falling in the Spirit? The anointing, the Spirit, the current, the force, they just can't stand in it. Why is it happening to some and not to others? Why is it not happening to you? Because there's all kinds of things blocking. Some of you not baptized. Some of you are not filled. Some of you are so in doubt when it comes to the things of the Spirit. You get caught up with all kinds of nonsense. Should I pray in the Spirit? Shouldn't I pray in the Spirit? Da, 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 da. And you're so focused over here that you stand in the... Amen. The Spirit comes, but you stand. This river will not flow. This river will not overflow me. Some of you are giggling, but that's exactly what you do. Shouldn't be like that. Shouldn't be like that. Should be a vessel that the Spirit flows through. How can you flow to people if you are not allowing Him to flow through you? You see, the problem with most Christians, they are not focused to allow the Spirit to flow through them or from them. They just want it for themselves. It's never been given. Guys, Pentecost was never, even though the believers were used, it was not, the effect was not seen on the believers. the effect was experienced by unbelievers. Thousands heard the gospel. Thousands got saved. Thousands became part. And you are here today. I don't know where you are in your journey with God. I don't know where you are. I'm not here to point fingers. I'm here to stir you. I'm here to cheer you. Listen, if you're not born again, get born again. It's so easy. Just turn to God. Look up to Him. He will come down to you. He will meet you where you are. If you are born again, get baptized if you're not baptized. If you are baptized, get filled if you're not filled. If you are filled, ask the Lord to flow through you and ask the Lord to use you to bring people through the journey so that you can seal them for the day of redemption. This message is not a rebuke. This message is to encourage you that Pentecost is a must. It's a celebration. It's the thing that Jesus is so excited about. We should live in Pentecost every day of our lives. Where are you with your walk with God? Where are you? This is what Jesus wants me to tell each and every one of you. There's more. You ain't seen nothing yet. There's much more for all of us. And I want to encourage you to go deeper, to go further in the things of the Spirit of God. Amen. Let's close our eyes. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for your word. Thank you that you love us, that you care about us, that you've got such a great plan and a future with all of us. We thank you that today we can experience your presence in our lives. Thank you that you have made your home in us. We give you all the glory that you loved us so much, that you saved us, created us anew, and empower us and guide us today through your Holy Spirit. We are your people. You are our God. And today I want to pray for those who do not know you as Lord and Savior. Those who are not born again. Those who do not have the assurance of eternal life. Before I go today, God, I want to give them an opportunity to accept you as their Lord and Savior. I want to give them an opportunity to reach out to you, because I know that you will come down to meet them where they are. Maybe you are here today, sitting in this auditorium and in any other auditorium or just listening to this message, and you know your life is not right with God. You do not have the full assurance of eternal life. Listen to me. God loves you. There's nothing that can separate you from the love of God. It doesn't matter what you've done. God will forgive you. But you need to reach out as He invites you to make right with Him. If it's you that I'm talking about, before we go today, you might be sitting in this campus and any other campus and you say, Thabo, today is my day. I'm going to make right with God. Can I please pray for you? If I can, I want to ask you quietly, unashamedly, to just quickly slip up your hand and say, show me by hand. Say, here I am. I want you to include me in a simple prayer. And then I'm going to pray for you. Is there anybody in this auditorium, there in our Seven Oaks campus, our Sawbridge campus, every other campus, and there in Amsterdam? Quickly just slip your hand up. Say, here I am, pray for me. If you've put it up, you can put it down. But today is your day. Thank you. I see your hand. Come on, God loves you. He's calling you to make right with Him, to receive eternal life. A brand new start, a new beginning. I'm going to ask one more time and then we're going to pray. You haven't put up your hand yet. You know you should. Just say, thank you. Thank you. At the back. We give you all the glory, Father. Let your kingdom come and your will be done. And all God's people say, amen. Please stand to your feet and give Jesus a big hand. And as we clap, I'm going to ask you to do something for me. You've put up your hand. You haven't put up your hand. There's many people that put up their hands. I want you to do me a big, big favor. I need to pray with you. I want to pray with you personally, and I want you to come out of your seat. I want you to make your way down to the altar in every auditorium. Come down if you are in the front here. Please make your way down to the altar. If you are sitting in the back of this auditorium, please come down to the glass section. In any other auditorium, quickly come out of your seat. Maybe ask the person next to you to walk with you. Make your way down to the altar in every campus. We're going to pray in a moment with you. So come to Jesus today. Come just as you are. Don't stay there in your seat. Respond to God right now. Get out of that seat and move towards God. In Jesus' name, come. Come to Jesus today. Amen and amen. Well, thank you so much for all of you. I just want to be obedient right now. I really feel that the Lord is saying to me that there's still people trapped in fear. You know that you should respond. You want to respond, but it feels like there's shackles around your feet. I want you to know how Satan works. Satan is your enemy, not God. Satan works in fear. As long as he can keep you in fear, you can't move in faith. And the Bible says we are saved by God's grace. That's what Jesus did. Through our faith, our response to the truth. So, I don't know where you are. Maybe you're sitting in this auditorium or any other auditorium, and you're still not in the front at the altar. I want to encourage you. Shake off the shackle, and just move, because now you are moving in faith. So remember, as you move towards God, God comes to meet you. So there's purpose in what we do. So I want you to leave your seat, move towards God, listen to what I tell you to do. I'm telling you to get out of your seat, come to God. We're going to pray together, and Jesus is going to meet you. So no matter where you are, I want to encourage you. Maybe if we only clap for you or wait for you in this auditorium or any other auditorium, we're going to clap one more time, but I want you to get out of your seat. And let us pray with you today. Your life is going to change forever. Quickly come. Quickly come. 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 We're going to clap for 2 minutes and then we're going to come. Come on, Dale Seven Oaks. Get out of your seat. Come. Dale Sawbridgeworth. Come on. Don't stay in your seat. Come to Jesus. Come on. He loves you. Awesome. Thank you. I want all you beautiful people to look up to me, please. Hey, this is a great day. You know, we are excited, but you've got no idea what's going on in heaven at the moment. Because the whole purpose of Jesus coming to this world is for this moment. I'm going to lead you in a simple prayer that will change your life forever. Thank you for the opportunity to pray with you. It's a huge honor. It's the greatest honor of my life to pray this prayer every time with people, because I know I've been there and I'm here now. And in this moment, God is going to take you from hell and place you in heaven. And you're going to become the son and daughter of God. Amen. So I want all of you that's standing in front of an auditorium, put your hand on your heart, close your eyes and pray this prayer out loud. Believe every word you say. So let's pray. Say, Heavenly Father, thank you for today that you spoke to my heart. I've heard your voice. Please forgive me of all my sins. I know I'm a sinner in need of your grace. And today, I receive your grace, your forgiveness, your love for me. Father, I believe of all my heart that Jesus is your Son. He's the Savior of the world. And today, I am saved. I am new. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Plant me in your church and use me for your glory among the nations of the world. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. You're standing in front of the auditorium. I want you to quickly look left, look right. You will find people waving at you at the moment. Please do me a kind favor. Follow them out of the auditorium. So we want to give you a gift and a Bible. We ain't going to do anything funny. We just want to bless you with a Bible and a gift, and then we're going to bring you straight back. So if you don't mind following the people out of the auditoriums, it will be appreciated. Thank you so much. Come on, church. Let's give the Lord a warm, well, heartfelt hand clap for all the salvations. Thank you so much for being with us today. If you are online and you've prayed that prayer, please go to our streaming platform. Put down your details so that we can get hold of you. We like to get the right materials to you, connect you to the household of God, and walk this journey with you. For all the other churches and campuses, thank you for being with us today. We're looking forward to have you tonight, same time, same place, and expect you to be with us next Sunday. Have a wonderful week. God bless you, and bye-bye.